old enough to remember Lauren Bacall. For you younger folks, she was a very glamorous Hollywood star. They had a very sexy voice. And so I'm using her voice this morning. And alas, unfortunately, that's the only resemblance. We're happy to have you here this morning. And this is the second class of JR's course on emotional well-being, from depression to happiness, Dr. J.R. Paulson.
Can you hear me in the back? Excellent. Well, thanks for coming back. It's always nice when the second night you get people coming back. Let's start out talking about, how was your homework assignment? I know you handed it in, but just some comments and I'll repeat it, Joanne. Did you have fun with that, or did it tickle your brain, or some interesting insights? Just let's share a couple things, somebody.
A little bit of a challenge.
A challenge? In what sense?
Try to put things in the right perspective.
Yes.
So it wasn't as easy as it sounded. The question was, yeah.
It was a challenge to remember how much to reveal.
A challenge of how much to reveal. Yeah, some people said they were going to be verbose, and I might figure out who they are from that. So some of you, I think I will know. Some of you shared with me after the talk last time some areas that you may have been more depressed than you ever let on to me or your doctor, as your doctor, or anyone else. Did you notice the physical was easier to do than the mental? I think most of us, well, hopefully, but most of us kind of can say, yeah, I remember at this time, and it might be in the future, but where we were on the physical scale. Remember, we're going to use these two parallel continuums. Did you notice any correlation between where you were on one and where you were on the other?
Yes.
A lot of people are saying yes.
No.
So if one was down, the other side might have been down too. And as one is really up, the other. But we're going to come back to that, particularly in the last class. I did it on one sheet of paper on purpose. There's symbolism in that. One mental, physical. And we'll come back to that theme a lot. We will have a homework assignment tonight, but I'll give you that at the end. Well, let's get started and tell you what we're going to be doing today. Emotional well-being from depression to happiness. Yes?
Can you turn down the volume?
Turn down the volume.
I'm turning it down. Keep talking.
Oh, he's turning it down.
Try it.
So, I'll keep talking, and can you still hear the back?
No,
they can't hear the back. So, Harvard George, let us know when you can first hear the back.
Move the microphone outboard.
Move it out further?
That's probably too much. Split the difference.
How's that?
That's pretty loud.
How's that?
There you go.
Okay. Well, thank you. Everybody pop up if you, it's too loud or too soft.
It's a little soft.
I'd like to see if we can get this August group to agree on a hypothesis that I have, that I think I can get all of you to agree on. Every person in this room. Now, the IQ points in this room is up there, I know. But between different political, religious, whatever, but there's one statement that I could maybe get you all to agree on, we'll vote on it. But I think there is, it has to do with this theme. So with that, let's take a look. First of all, can you get the lights down a little bit so we can read that? Bob sent me this. We were about walk faster, live longer. Statistician at Berkeley found 40,000 men and women who walk for more than 10 years. So this is a good study. 10 years, a lots of people. His latest report shows that the faster you walk, the longer you live. When you take it sick, the longer you live. Picking up the pace is more helpful than just walking slowly. Even if you go longer than the recommended 30 minutes a day, in the study group, who walked very slow pace, were 44% more likely to die. 44% in 10 years for those who walked at a faster pace. Obviously, the runners made a difference. So thanks, Bob. And we're going to come back to the physical fitness continuum and how you can move up to the higher end of that again. But I thought that was kind of interesting data that played right into what we're talking about. By the way, do you think if you are up higher on the emotional well-being chart, you're going to live longer?
Yes.
Yeah. Yes. The data? Yes. Data shows that a lot. I'll show you why and the cause and the studies in a little bit. Okay, the goal of this class, my goal is the sound mind and the sound body. I'm going to go back and forth between them. I don't think you can do one well without the other. And this is the statement that I want you to vote on. Happiness is the meaning and purpose of life, the whole aim and end of human existence. Sometime we were talking to one of our friends, Howard Brookwell, what is the meaning of life before he died? He was always wrestling with this issue. As a philosophy major, I remember this from Aristotle. I also remember my sophomoric arguments with friends. Well, I don't want to be my happiness. I want my kids to be happy. Yeah, but that makes you happy. And every time you say, well, I want something else, even if it's for somebody else, altruistic, why do you want to do that for somebody else? Well, it makes me happy. It always comes back to make you happy. Now, so far, I've not found much of a flaw in that. Jim?
Is happiness defined by me or by society?
Question, is happiness defined by me or society? And the answer is clearly by me. Yes?
Isn't happiness an abnormal state, though? I mean, if you don't have happiness, I mean, you must have sadness in order to balance to understand what happiness is, right? So happiness is the opposite end of the spectrum from sadness. So wouldn't balance be more of an ideal?
Absolutely. The question is, we're all happy up here. In other words, nirvana, heaven, everybody's happy. Should that be our goal? So that's a question. Should it be our goal? And I'm going to posit, no, it should not be our goal. It's unrealistic, it's stupid, it's unattainable. Personally, I would not want to live in a heaven that's perfect. I can't imagine that. That would be hell to me. I mean, in a sense. I'll explain that later when we get into the theological part. But yes, having everything perfect all the time, you need the other to balance. So one of the points, and here's the take-home point that I want you to think of, is life is, or should be, in my opinion, a teeter-totter. So yes, you can be up. So this will be up, emotional health. This will be down. And I'm going to posit that what's best is a teeter-totter that centers around a fulcrum kind of in the middle. And that we really do kind of this. Now, if you're manic-depressive, you'll do this and be manic, but you'll be suicidal and so depressed you can't function at the other end. Also, the second theme is that I'm going to posit physically and more important emotionally, this is a movable, that this does go up and down. If you don't want it to go down, it ain't going to stay, something's going to happen that's going to tip it up or down. Whether other people, the world, so even if you're sitting up here and smiling in the catbird seat, it's just a matter of time before something's going to come at the other end that's going to tip you a little bit. Correct? So, 2 points, excellent. I planted him in the back. Now, another thing that we like to live more up here, though. I think we'd all agree that. We don't want to get stuck down here with the teeter-totter down on the ground on our butt. That is no, that's not fun. That's painful. That's what we would call suffering. We don't want that for ourselves or others. So ideally, we'd like that. So I think as a goal, not as a permanent place to live, can we agree that happiness is the meaning, purpose of our existence, that we would like to get, and our family and our friends and all of the world to be more up this way than that way? Okay? Let's stick with that, and we're going to come back to that. Now, unfortunately, down at the other end of the spectrum are people that have depression. So a lot of this talk is going to be about depression. I hope it isn't too depressing. So before we can talk about the treatment of depression, which we will get into and I want to do, we have to have a model that postulates the causes or cause or causes. It's always been that way. You need a model for what you're going to do. So let's briefly review medical models over time. But first, I want to take a couple minutes and just throw up some ideas. If I say, what causes depression? And a one-word answer. Anybody, two-word answers?
Illness.
Loss.
Genetics.
Pardon?
Genetics.
Frustration.
Rejection.
Fear.
Poverty.
Wealth.
Disasters.
Physical or mental? Physical disasters. Yes?
I'd say that none of those things cause depression, because it's a chemical imbalance in your brain. Everybody suffers loss, grief, poverty at some time or other, and that might help tip the scale if you're kind of depressed and make it worse, but they are not the root cause of depression, because you get over those things. And there are a lot of people that live in poverty all their life and are content or happy.
So the question and comment was, a lot of people live in poverty and they're happy. Things come and go, but the ultimate common pathway that he posits is that it ends up being your chemicals in your brain. And when your chemicals in your brains are wacko, that leads to a lot of the manifestations. So there may be events, but the chain is events causing chemical changes in the brain, and that causes depression. Is that what you're saying?
Right. You can have an otherwise wonderful life and still be depressed.
If you're saying your chemicals are screwed up. Yes?
It's your attitude. Your personal attitude when you reach each of those things. It's your attitude. We're all born with one stringed instrument, our attitude, and how you go through each of those things.
It was positing that it's your attitude that determines a lot of the where you are on the teeter-totter of emotional wellness. We're all born with one string, that she said, and that's kind of what's going to determine that. Yeah, Harry.
I was just going to comment to that. So if that's the case, then it's your fault. If your attitude is bad, you brought it on yourself. And
okay.
I would not like to think that would be, you know.
So what Harriet is saying is that if it's your attitude, and then you're depressed or you're happy, it's your fault. But if you're depressed, you only have the person to blame is yourself, because it's your own dang attitude. So that puts a little moral quandary on here. This is good, because it's going to lead in to the model that we use for depression is going to very greatly determine not only how we treat it, but how we view it. So with that, let's take a little zippity-doo-dah time through history and see what other people have done, other physicians, and how they have looked at the idea of depression. Okay? So hopefully this will be fun and exciting. Depression has always been a health problem for human beings. Documents written by healers, philosophers, and writers through the ages point to the long-standing existence of depression as a health problem. It's been around forever. And the continuous and sometimes ingenious struggles people have made to find ways to treat the illness. The father of medicine, Hippocrates, is considered the first physician to actually describe melancholia or depression clinically. He said, we got a clinical state here. It isn't just, you know, a mood you feel up or you're down. We got a state here called clinical depression. It was initially called melancholia. The earliest accounts appeared in the ancient Mesopotamian texts around the second millennium before the Common Era. At this time, all mental illnesses were attributed to be demonic possessions and were tended to by priests. But in contrast, you had some of these physicians who were not looked at very highly in society. They were considered artisans who treated physical injuries, but they didn't treat depression. So the first understanding of depression, it was a spiritual or mental illness and not a physical. So that's what we kind of start with in recorded histories. Well, Hippocrates suggested that personality traits and mental illness were related to balanced or imbalanced body fluids called humors. There were four of these: yellow bile, black bile, phlegm, and blood. Hippocrates classified mental illness into categories. He said there's mania, there's depression, and there's also this phrenitis called brain fever. He thought that melancholia was caused by too much black bile in the spleen. He used bloodletting, but also bathing, exercise, and dieting, kind of holistic, to treat depression. Now, in contrast to Hippocrates' view, the Roman philosopher and statesman Cicero argued that melancholy was caused by violent rage, fear, grief, or loss, and used a mental explanation rather than a physical one. So already you got two camps going here. It's laws, this, no, it's these humors in you that are screwed up. Hippocrates, we got to give him credit. He was on the money on this. Men ought to know that from the brain, and from the brain only, arises our pleasures, joys, laughter, and jests, as well as our sorrows, pains, griefs, and fears. Through it, in particular, we think, see, hear, and distinguish the ugly from the beautiful, the bad from the good, and the pleasant from the unpleasant. But it's also the same thing that makes us mad or delirious, inspires us with dread and fear, whether by night or by day, brings sleeplessness, inappropriate mistake or inopportune mistakes, aimless anxieties, absent-mindedness, and acts that are contrary to habit. These things that we suffer all come from the brain. When it's not healthy, but becomes abnormally hot, cold, moist, or dry, or suffers from any other unnatural affection to which it was not accustomed. Madness comes from moistness. So we got the first part right. It's in the brain, but I don't know if we call this moist, cold stuff, right? But he's got it in the brain. I mean, that's, he's figuring it out. That's pretty good. This theory of humors lasted, that's a long time. Almost two and a half millennia. And as you can see, you know, you have the yellow bile, black bile, phlegm, and they're tied to the earth, fire, air, and water, and wet, and the seasons, and age, and they're all working together. So this is the model. And look how long the model lasted. Amazing is right, because we believed in authority. Treatment. So, rebalancing the humors through bloodletting, but Hippocrates also prescribed changes in diet and oral herbs, such as mandrake and hellebore. Those are herbs that grew around the Mediterranean. And it's a little flower. And earlier was thought to cure madness because there was a king whose daughters were mad, and somebody back in Greece gave him the daughters hellebore, and they became unmad. So they thought it was great. Later, in the medieval times, the Dark Ages, hellebores are used by witches. Hellebores to bring out the witches. And cathartics and emetic drugs and plants thought to eliminate black bile. So in other words, if you came to me, I'd give you stuff to make you throw up and go at the other end. so I can get the bylaw. Seriously, that was the main thing. So I think I'm going to form my own herbal therapy stuff for depression. And I was looking back and I went to found the Egyptian, on the Eber papyrus, there was a nice herbal mix that I can make because I got most of the stuff. But I don't have lotus flowers. So you have lotus flowers, and you use some watermelon, and some beer, sweet beer, and some wine. And the coup de grace is cat dung. And we have three cats, so we have an abundance of cat dung. And what you do is make this into a poultice, and you wear this, and this will help your depression. So if you come to my office and you're a little depressed, and I suggest you this bag of stuff, and it's pretty sticks, you know I've gone to. But if I follow this model, hopefully Dr. Jerry has a different model. Plato, pretty famous philosopher, and Socrates were resistant. Really, this body stuff, this organic stuff, felt deep disorders of mind should only be treated by philosophers.
Right.
Well, you gonna argue with Plato and Socrates? He was the first to talk about the developmental model. That suggested that a man's childhood determined his adult character, for good or evil, to a large degree. The family was of supreme importance in shaping later personal, social, and political traits. That's pretty advanced thinking at that. So this other stuff is, but he's the first one to start thinking about that. Next, he saw the mind as three parts: the rational, the libidinal, and the spiritual. Their minds have these three components. But he predated Freud by several thousand years. When we come back to Freud a little later today, we'll talk about the ego, the id, and it's like, ooh, Plato is rational, sex drive, and spiritual. Aristotle, of course, he was the authority figure of the time. Anything Aristotle said was pretty much, people believed it. He said the heart was the organ responsible for the regulation of the four humors, and that either heat or cold could disrupt the balance. However, he also thought that a certain amount of cold and black bile was necessary for genius. First comes in, you get a little bit of depression, a little bit of craziness if you want to be creative. That was seminal seed by Aristotle. Very interesting. Galen, I don't know if anybody recognizes him, I didn't, but he's a famous second century Greek physician, and he was the most influential and famous because he was a personal physician to the emperor, Marcus Aurelius. So if you're the chief doc for the head guy, and you write stuff or tell stuff, plus he's choosing you to take care of him, he's got some credibility. He was also a philosopher, so he, I think Plato and Aristotle probably have him. And he tried to reconcile both the physical and the psychological. See, well, we don't have to have both separate.
I was going
to
ask.
It could be maybe we'll treat both things. Pretty good idea. This patient with melancholia experience, this is his description: scarce, turbulent, and interrupted sleep. Palpitations, vertigo, sadness, anxiety, diffidence. Which I had to look up, because I thought a difference. Let's see, what's that? Hesitant in acting or speaking due to a lack of self-confidence. It's a good word, I like that. And the belief of being persecuted or being possessed by a demon, hated by the gods. So some of his patients, this is a pretty wide spectrum there. And he patented an antidote of plantains, mandrake, linden flowers, opium. That's going to make everybody feel good. That's pretty clever. These guys were not, had some arugula for health, for depression, and anxiety. So if you came in to him and he says, I'm depressed or anxious, he'd give you some of this. Well, I mean, you probably feel pretty good, baby.
Better than that Egyptian one.
Better than the Egyptian one. Thanks, Doctor. But, Galen shared the common belief of the time that deficient sexual release had disastrous consequences and led to depression. Oh. Wow. I love this story from him. He treated one of his female patients whose brain, he believed, was troubled by the noxious fumes of her unreleased sexual fluids. So, with a manual stimulation of the vagina and of the clitoris, and the patient took great pleasure from this. Much liquid came out, and she was cured. So your theory of disease is kind of important. Now, medical diagnosis, doctors at that time, also hysteria. So let's talk a little bit about hysteria. Anyone know the name, what hysteria means? It's a Greek word that means wandering uterus. Wandering uterus. So it's an unmanageable emotional excess, exclusively in women. That was pretty sharp. It's often centered on a body part or imagined fear of something wrong with that part. So women come in, they're anxious, and there's something wrong with me, and I don't know what it is, and I'm just kind of hysterical, and you gotta fix this, doctor, and no, I can't sleep in this. Yeah, yeah. For thousands of years, I'm not making this stuff up, it was often treated by the physician with what we would now call genital masturbation. The Victorian era pelvic massage was a common practice. So if you went there and you were a female and you had these complaints, that's what you would probably ask for, and that is what you would get. However, not only did the doctors not regard the required vulvar stimulation as having anything to do with sex, but they found it both time-consuming and hard work. Dr. Paulson, we have four women out here that are looking for treatment of their anxiety. They've already known behind. Okay, so the human mind and engineering being what it is, the first steam-powered vibrator called the manipulator was invented by the American George Taylor doctor in 1869. Steam-powered. And around 1880, Joseph Mortimer Granville invented the first electric vibrator in England. The device was heralded as a wonderful invention by doctors and probably shyly by patients alike. The doctors literally got tendonitis and they couldn't use their hands to do surgery later. So here's the robot catalog. So in the early century here, these were in advertisements were in crocheting magazines and other things about the vibrators, without the sexual connotation, but trust me, it's in there. So this was common in self-treatment at this time in our country here for quite a while. By the way, the court, at least in England, could and often did order women to have forced hysterectomies if they were found too unruly. So the court could send and choose a woman to have a hysterectomy to control your behavior. It was not until 1980 that the American Psychiatric Association officially changed the term in diagnosis to conversion disorder. So it's a year before I joined Dr. Ferguson, so I went, this is good. The purchase of vibrators are still illegal, by the way, in Alabama. And they had a court case, I thought, interesting, on Valentine's Day, that came down in 2007, that upheld that. So every state in the union, you can buy a vibrator, but not in Alabama. Unless you come to me and I give you a doctor's note. This is still on the books. Question, does Medicare cover that? I don't know, because I've never had to write a note. I've never wrote notes for a lot of stuff. I'll have to look that up. If you want to see a fun movie that's historically correct, this movie called Hysteria really is kind of neat. Because that tells the story of that. It shows what it was like. It's kind of neat. Well, it's not 13 and under, let's put it that way. This is an advertisement, and of course, here's the doctors here with this little velvet pelvic thing that kind of protects so a woman can see what's going on. These guys are talking about what they're doing. The old doctor is instructing the new one on the proper technique for this. And of course, not in our movie posters, but this was in the Italian movie posters. They would put that up. We wouldn't have that downtown, you know, here. But that's Granville's first electric vibrator, so you can see what it kind of looked like. Okay, you guys need a break in. That was the electric part, yes.
Is this session being taped for TV?
Probably. This group here is not... This is medical stuff. Temperaments. Galen also formulated the idea of 9 temperaments. Each a type of soul, almost dominated by melancholia. Conceived not as pathology, but as part of the self. There are people who are by nature anxious, depressed, anguished, always pensive. For them, a doctor can do little. So you got a personality kind of disorder that's one of these temperaments. Are you going to change your temperament? Is that genetics, or you just kind of be that way? Well, he said, I can't do much about that. But at least thought about temperaments. The Middle Ages. In the Middle Ages in Europe, from the fall of the Roman Empire, 5th century, to the 15th century, religious beliefs, specifically Christianity, dominated concepts of mental illness. Much of society believed that the mentally ill were possessed by the devil or demons, or accused them of being witches and infecting others with madness. Therefore, instead of receiving care from physicians, mentally ill were objects of cruel and barbaric treatment. So you change your model now. It's not humors. It's now a spiritual disease. Samuel. Now the Spirit of the Lord departed from Saul, and an evil spirit from the Lord tormented him. And Saul's servant said to him, Behold now, an evil spirit from God is tormenting you. Let our Lord now command your servants who are before you to seek out a man who is skillful in playing the lyre. And when the evil spirit from God is upon you, he will play it and you will be well. So that's the only thing you had, a little music therapy going for you. If God chose to do these spirits. St. Augustine believed that melancholy is a mark of God's disfavor. This punishment for a sinning soul. Melancholic despair suggested that a person was not suffused with joy at the certain knowledge of God's divine love and mercy. Melancholy, in this view, was a turning away from all that was holy. Thomas Aquinas believed, as did most people of the time, separation of the body and soul. Descartesian dualism. The body and the soul are not put together, they're different. And the soul is placed high above the body, because the soul is given from God. And because of the hierarchy, the soul is not subject to body illness. They're drawing the line here and saying, no, the body doesn't affect the soul. The soul's pure. It's God-given. So don't be doing this humor stuff. Among the 9 deadly sins, later reduced to 7, lascivia, later translated as sloth, was one of them. This description was similar to some of our current symptoms of depression today. Now you see, everything has changed now. This is what acedia, like, you're just kind of lazy, you don't do much, just kind of sit around. Or Bruegel's painting, which I love his, and you can spend a lot of time looking around here for symbolism and metaphor of sloth. 1670, church minister took the view that insanity and depression were caused by life circumstances. And moral choices in sins of an individual that induced bad melancholy blood. So he's saying, choices you make And like circumstances, they change the blood. There's a cause and effect here. Does that make sense? A couple more, then we'll take our break. But possession is still the medical treatment of the day. This is St. Catherine over on the right, exercising. See this devil coming out of this woman's head. This is what the Middle Ages is the model for depression or melancholy. This was the time of the Black Death. This was not a good time to be a doctor or a patient. Let's just get to the Renaissance and take a break. Renaissance, which began in Italy in the 14th century, went up to the 16th and 17th, we moved a little farther ahead. The witch hunts were still going on, mentally ill was still common throughout England. On the other hand, some doctors returned to the view of Hippocrates, saying that maybe it was due to natural causes, that witches really aren't mentally disturbed, that really maybe they just need some humane treatment instead of just killing them or torturing them. 1621, Robert Burton published, this is the classic tome, The Anatomy of Melancholy, which he describes the psychological and social causes, poverty, fear, solitude, some things you already mentioned a while ago, and depression. In his encyclopedic work, he recommended diet, exercise, travel, distraction, still purgatives, unfortunately, some bloodletting, marriage, and even music therapy for depression. So he comes up with a physical explanation for melancholy. Our body is like a clock, and if one of the wheels be amiss, the rest are disordered. So you see where we're kind of going with this. So it's more mechanical type stuff. Ficino proposed that artistic creation relied on the muse who descends during temporary insanity. Melancholy was a prerequisite to inspiration. The sixth chapter of his book was entitled, How Black Bile Makes People Intelligent. The Renaissance attempted to merge the classical ideas of temperament and humors with the new fascination of horoscopes. So Saturn, as the weighty, isolated, ambivalent planet, reigned over melancholy. So now you're bringing the stars, you're coming in control of what you're doing. And to be genius or a great painter, artist, musician, you're a little off, so we all know that little boundary between great art and is too far away, that came from here. And one picture of melancholy, and from the Middle Ages, and here's the muse sitting on here. So this person is sitting around, but they're just ready to get inspired by the muse. So with that, let's us take a little break, and then we'll return in a little bit.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you for giving your seats again. Well, that was an entertaining as well as educational first half. So here we have the second half of JR's class on emotional well-being, JR Paulson.
Hey, thanks, Joanne. So if you went to a psychiatrist at that time, what would he probably do? He wasn't called a psychiatrist, he was called a barber. To the barbers, that's why they have their insignia, that little candy cane, that blood is because they were blood letters. So that's why the barber's symbol is the way it is. A circle of blood running down your arm. Seriously. Trepanation. This practice as early as 10,000 BC, but was revived in the 18th century. It was a process in which a hole was drilled literally in the top of your head, and the hole was believed to release evil elements that cause madness. And the patients usually lived through this. We find lots of skulls in Mesoamerica that have holes in their head, and it wasn't from a bullet or whatever, it was medically done. Another nice artistic picture by Sir Charles Bell in 1806. Shakespeare, at that time, I went too far. Voltaire, we gotta get him first, Age of Enlightenment. Voltaire, one of my favorite philosophers, he didn't have much faith in physicians. He said, doctors pour drugs of which they know little for diseases of which they know less into patients whom they know nothing. Voltaire's pretty witty and catches it succinctly. And unfortunately, I think some practitioners today
do that.
Do that. Seriously. Take this drug and... Shakespeare didn't have much faith in physicians either. More need she the divine than the physician. God, God forgive us. Comments of the physician, called to treat Lady Macbeth's madness. He was smart, at least said, this is out of my realm. This lady's too crazy, you know, I'm not going to be able to help her. This is a spiritual problem. In the beginning of the Age of Enlightenment, 18th, 19th centuries, it was thought that depression was sometimes now inherited in an unchangeable weakness of the temperament, which leads to the common thought that affected people should be shunned or locked up. As a result, most people with mental illness became homeless, poor, and some were committed to institutions. That was changing a little bit. Now they're crazy, you're born, it's genetics, this is your temperament, and you're in trouble. The Church of Our Lady that is named Bedlam, that was named in London, St. Mary's of Bethlehem is the original name, changed to Bedlam. And in that place befall many men that be fallen out of their wit. In full honesty, they be kept in that place, and some be restored into their wit and health again, and some be abiding there forever. For they be fallen so much out of themselves that it is incurable unto man. So the mayor of London. So if you went into a mental institution at that time, is very good chances you won't come out. And this is a picture of the three different hospitals of Bedlam, but this is one of the original ones, and then they ended up moving, but they still have it. Picture of some of the inmates there. And during this time, they actually charged admission. So to the people, like, you know, people would go to hangings back then. It was a big deal to go to public hangings. You could buy tickets to go into Bedlam and see all the crazy people. Help pay some of the overhead for the hospital. From the beginning of the 19th century, new therapies for depression, including water immersion, keeping people underwater for as long as possible without drowning them. Waterboarding before, and a special spinning stool to induce dizziness, to rearrange the contents of the brain into the correct position. In addition, Benjamin Franklin introduced an early form of electron shock therapy. Good old Ben. Horseback riding, diets, enemas and vomiting were also recommended. Not a good time to have depression. The crib. People will often put in the crib if your behavior was a little too outlandish. Put in there for long periods of time. The vomiting machines. They could spin your head around this way if they thought it was more mechanically advantaged to move stuff that way, or they could do it sitting way. And they would continue to whirl you until you had your vertigo and dizziness and vomiting. That was one of your therapies that you could look forward to. The douche, water torture. And they had different forms of this waterboarding. Same thing that you do, just continually have some mechanism of pouring water on people. Getting back to the sexual theme here. In 1729, the doctor perfected a system of torture that cured the insane that he learned from this other doctor. And he cured a woman. She was mad, neglected everything, was kept in a room, would converse with nobody, but she was withdrawn. She had melancholia. She had depression. But she refused to have sex with her husband. That was not good. For 7 weeks, before water treatment, she had frequent bleedings, emetics, purgatives, potent soporifics, which are things to make you sleep, and narcotics, and they tried that, it didn't work. So, this brought about partial cure. She did okay, but she still didn't like her husband. So we gotta change this woman. So they strapped her naked into the chair and put her in an inexpressible terror, especially when the water was let down. So they waterboarded her. Kept her under 30 minutes, stopping the pipe now and then, and inquiring whether she would take her husband. But she still said, nope, I'm not going to. Even though she was fatigued with this. Next day, she refused again. So, water torture again, two more times. But when she recovered again, she refused. So Bear said, quote, I threatened her with a fourth trial. Took her out of bed and she... Okay, so I threatened her with a fourth trial. Took her out of bed, had her stripped, blindfolded, and ready to be put in the chair. So I'm looking at the stuff for me to see. When being terrified what she was going to know, she said no. She would become a loving, obedient, and dutiful wife forever after. I granted her request, provided she would go to bed with her husband that night, which she did with great cheerfulness. About a month afterward, I went to pay her a visit and saw everything was good. Can you believe this? I mean, you know, wife's not going to sleep in the depressed, so we'll water torture you until you do it. Doesn't have anything on the CIA. At this time, it's important to remember that any doctor before 1900 had the equivalent, I like this quote, medical knowledge of today's average 13-year-old. He's playing with his chemistry set he got for his birthday and dissected a few raccoons on his backyard picnic table. Apart from a crude knowledge of chemistry and a basic understanding of the physiology of the human body, doctors had everything else wrong. Well, we were just not very sharp at this time. Recognize this guy, Philip Pinel in France. This is Philip Pinel around 1800 in France, and he became the administrator of the prison for insane women. And he said, don't keep these people all chained up. This is ridiculous. This isn't how you treat sick, mentally insane, depressed people. You treat them humanely. So he got them out of the chain. So this is a classic painting of unchaining the women in the same asylum in Salpêtre in Paris. And if he got the staff, any staff was treating person badly or nastily, they were summarily disciplined. So he did not put up with any. So total change here now. The people are, we don't have much treatment to get better. And we also will talk to him, we'll let him get up and do some things. Big change. The Islamic world, as I told in one of my other classes, was ahead of the Western world in a lot of different things. Well, in the world of North Africa, Spain, and the Middle East, generally had a more humane attitude toward people with mental illness. Following the belief that God loved insane people too, they're like everybody else, communities began establishing asylums in the 18th century AD, first in Baghdad, later in Cairo, Damascus, and Fez. Asylums offered patients special diets, baths, drugs, music, and pleasant surroundings. So they were way ahead of us on how you treat the mentally insane or depressed. How about the United States? The most famous figure in the United States was Benjamin Rush. You can see the dates there. He was a pretty famous guy for a lot of reasons. He signed the Declaration of Independence, he was American Revolution, he was elected to Congress, set up private practice, treasurer of the Mint. I mean, he was established two colleges in Pennsylvania, I don't know which one, but
Dickinson
and Rush in Chicago is probably named after him, I would think. And he's the father of American psychiatry. And he published this tome on observation of diseases of the mind. That, most people, that was the Bible for about 50 years. He believed that mental diseases were caused by an irritation of blood vessels in the brain. His treatment included bleeding, purging, hot and cold baths, mercury, and he invented a tranquilizer chair and a gyrator for psychiatric patients. He was kind of continuing on some of the same stuff. So he developed this chair. This is the tranquilizing chair developed by Benjamin Rush, an advocate for the humane treatment of the mentally ill, used to restrain patients for hours at a time. It's a little oxymoron there, you know, humane treatment. So this is, he went into one of the times, he invented this chair and thought it was a good breakthrough for people. It's even got his potty underneath it, because you're there so long. Rush is sometimes considered a pioneer of occupational therapy. He did make some tremendous things. In Diseases of the Mind, he wrote, it's been remarked, and I have to stand back here so I can see what I'm reading, that the maniacs of the male sex in all hospitals who assist in cutting wood, making fires, digging in a garden, and the females who are employed in washing, ironing, and scrubbing floors often recover, while persons whose rank exempts them from performing said services languish away their lives within the walls of the hospital. Isn't that interesting? So get them out and do some things and they get better. But if you're an uppity-uppity and you don't have to do stuff like that, you may not get out. Very good. He was also the first one to pioneer treat the alcoholism and substance abuse. Prior to his work, drunkenness was viewed as being sinful and just a matter of choice. See, we're getting the moral thing here. Rush believed that alcoholic loses control over himself and identified the properties of alcohol rather than the alcoholic's choice as the causal agents. He developed the conception of alcoholism as a form of medical disease and proposed that alcoholics should be weaned from their addiction via less potent substances. New, totally new different thought for alcoholism. This, I think, is clever. I think I want to get this blown up and put this in my office. It's just it's neat. A moral and physical thermometer, or the scale of the progress of temperance and intemperance, liquors with their effects in their useful order. So on this side, you have a thermometer. And this is the strength of booze. So here, water, milk and water, small beer, cider, wine, porter, strong beer, toddy, grog, stronger stuff going down this way. And then over on the right side, temperance. If you're up here drinking water, and maybe it's a small beer, serenity of the mind, happiness. You get down here, still cheerfulness, strength, nourishment. When taken only at meals, and in moderate quantities. So he says, you're okay with some even strong beer if you do it in this way. But you get down here and you get intemperance. And it causes vices, disease, and there's going to be consequences. The vices, the fighting, lying, fraud, anarchy, hatred, murder, and even suicide down here. Diseases, you get gout. Get stiff necks, red face, you get some of the symptoms, dropsy, melancholy, depression, apathy, and you drink enough, you die. And then punishments, debt, black eyes, rags, hunger, work, frail, whippings, and finally, if you're cattle hand, and then finally, if you're bad enough, you go to the gallows. What is that? Just priceless? I just, yeah. Just love that. Oh, he's got all this stuff on there. It's kind of cool. Put that up in the high school and the
yeah.
One other person I'll mention, Dorothea Dix, because when my kids live in Raleigh, they have Dorothea Dix Mental Hospital there. But she was a school teacher and she was really big foremost advocate for humane care of the mentally ill during the 19th century. And she is credited with establishing 32 state and mental hospitals throughout the United States. So she was really a pioneer in that area. Finally, two new models for depression and anxiety emerged, the psychoanalytic and the biochemical. Depression was first distinguished from schizophrenia in 1895 by the German psychiatrist Emil Krigman. During the same period, psychodynamic theory was invented and psychoanalysis became increasingly popular as a treatment. Sigmund Freud, in his essay, Melancholy, 1917, was the seminal work. And he said it's a response to loss. Either real loss, that's just the death of a spouse, because some of you mentioned what are causes of depression, you said loss. Well, Freud hopped on that. So real loss or symbolic loss, such as the failure to achieve an important goal. Freud believed that a person's unconscious anger over loss weakened the ego, resulting in self-hatred and self-destructive behavior. And he advocated psychoanalysis or the talking cure to resolve unconscious conflicts and reduce the need for self-abusive thoughts and behaviors. Other doctors during this time viewed depression as a physical disease and a brain disorder. So here now you've got it. It's what? It's a mental thing. It has to do with thoughts that you have, conflicts within your brain. Subconscious that you may not even aware of. Pretty breakthrough idea. So it gave us a much better understanding of somatic depression and schizophrenia. And it looked into the lives of patients, so you had to talk to them. You couldn't just do stuff or encourage them or love them. And, of course, his idea is that much of what we do is kind of down here in this unconscious, below the surface. We have our conscious idea, thoughts and feelings, and there's a pre-consciousness. Yeah, you can recall this, and the ego's up here, but then you got down the id here. Hey, it sounds like Aristotle. Some of these unconscious urges and primal drives that you got, but they're buried down here, and you don't know that you got those, but Freud says they're there. And you got the superego over there. It's kind of a little conscience thing. So, let me give you two slides of the summary of Freud. Freud divided the mind into three parts, id, ego, and superego. Each part of the mind is responsible for something different. It and the superego are comparable to the angel and the devil sitting on one's shoulders. So the id's, the impulsive, childlike portion of the psyche, operates on the pleasure principle. It only takes into account what it wants and disregards all consequences. It's equivalent to the devil sitting on one shoulder, like that. Superego plays the critical and moralizing role in the psyche. Aims for perfection, includes ego's ideals, punishes misbehavior with feelings of guilt. Superego is equivalent to the angel on one shoulder. There's a lot of interesting symbolism in there, isn't it? I mean, yeah. And the ego, the organized, realistic portion of the psyche that acts, according to the reality principle, it's in the real world. So it seeks pleasure, its drive in realistic ways, it will benefit in the long term rather than bringing grief. Ego is equivalent to one's consciousness. And later in this course, I'm gonna build on some of this Freudian stuff. So, theory of personality, I want it now, the id, to be go. You can't have it. It's not right. Ego. I need to figure out a plan on how to get this. You know, but isn't there some truth to that in this? I mean, we poo-poo Freud, but some of these conflicts and ideas, we're going to go further with this depression. And are medicines or purgings or water torture going to do anything for this? Don't think so. Unless you analyze that. Now, a book I'm reading called The Noonday Demon, it's about this thick on the history of depression. The author, who's gone through major breakdowns himself, he lives in Manhattan and all of his breakdowns, and he has a psychotherapist and also a pharmacologist, a neuropharmacologist. He's got both. And he talks about going to a psychotherapist 5 days a week. Wow. $200 a crack. And I'm thinking, you are in a world that, you know, And he's been doing this 13, 14, 20, 15 zillion years. And so in the real world, most of us don't have to go to our psychotherapist and spend, you know, an hour or two, 5 days a week and pay for it. Okay, treatments during the late 19th to 20th century were usually inadequate for people with severe depression. We're still not getting these people cured. As a result, many desperate people were treated with lobotomy. The surgical destruction of the frontal portion of a person's brain, which became popular as calming treatment at this time. Lobotomies were often unsuccessful, causing personality changes, inability to make decisions. That's the executive part of the brain, that's what it does. Or worse, coma, sometimes death. Electroconvulsive therapy, which I'll talk about later, was popular treatment for schizophrenics. But this treatment was also used for depressed people. The surgical procedure for lobotomy began as a treatment for schizophrenics in 1946. It was proven effective, but was no longer considered necessary to control psychotic symptoms with the introduction of antipsychotic drugs. So at that time, they invented Thorazine, and the antipsychotic drugs, they could just give you some Thorazine and calm people down. They didn't have to take you and tap you. So for schizophrenia, they kind of left those folks alone for a while. We'll see what else they did for them. The early lobotomy procedures were performed with an ice pick in the frontal lobe of the brain. The director of the procedure, Walter Freeman, won the Nobel Prize. Yes, for that.
Oh my gosh.
And here's a picture of him. He's on the cover of I'm trying to think of the date, in the 40s, on Saturday Evening Post. That was the cover. So if you go back in your archives, a picture of him looking at with his other colleague there. Freeman would go on to perform 2,500 lobotomies. Known as a showman, he once performed 25 lobotomies in a day. To shock his audiences, he also liked to insert picks in both eyes simultaneously. No, this is true. This is not ridiculous. According to an NPR article, the procedure went as follows. As those who watched the procedure described it, the patient would be rendered unconscious by electroshock. So you zap them, unconscious. Freeman would then take a sharp ice pick instrument, insert it above the patient's eyeballs, I'm not going to demonstrate that to any of you, through the orbit, into the eye, into the frontal lobe of the brain, and then move the instrument back and forth. Then they do the same thing on the other. To cure depression and... you guys, you lived through this stuff. This was going on. This was going on a lot. 1967, so it went almost 20 years, performed his last lobotomy before being banned. Why the ban? After he performed the third lobotomy on a longtime patient of his, she developed brain hemorrhage and died. I think the lawyers probably got involved and said, you're not doing any more of these. But in the U.S., performed more lobotomies than any other country. Sources vary on the exact number, between 40 and 50,000. I don't think any of you in here have had that procedure. Yes?
I heard a recent NPR article about this Freeman, and a lot of them were veterans, and it was done at VA hospitals.
Question is, a lot of these were done on veterans in VA hospitals. Why? Because they came back with, now we call it post-traumatic stress disorder. And they're having all these flashbacks and all these bad things from war. And we don't have anything to do with them. They don't have much medicines. So we'll calm them down and we'll do that. Now, I like this. Curiously, as early as 1950, some nations, including Germany and Japan, had outlawed lobotomies. The Soviet Union prohibited the procedure in 1950, stating it was contrary to the principles of humanity. How ironic. So here we are going along doing lobotomies, and everybody, the Russians are going, this is inhumane. You guys are nuts. If you want to see a neat movie, how many people have seen Shutter Island? pretty powerful, pretty true. That's what life was like if you were crazy at that time and you were in a mental institution. And we all know what happens to our friend Leonardo at the end of the movie. I'll just give a little notice the slide that it's following. But anyways, it's really a pretty intense movie. So overview, 30s and 40s. One of the other things they did was let's induce seizures. These methods were based on the observation that epilepsy seldom occurred along with schizophrenia. When they do, the psychotic symptoms usually decrease after an epileptic fit. Later, these procedures were also used to treat manic depression and autism. So the logic here, people who have seizures, epilepsy,
so we'll induce seizures.
And you give seizures, and then the people aren't going to be so psychotic. Mm-hmm. I mean, and based on that model, we did lots of electroshock for that. Some of you remember this movie, On the Floor of the Cuckoo's Nest.
Yes.
Nicholson.
Yeah.
So this is how we use the compulsion. It's very scratchy. Yeah. Now, in the 50s, psychotherapy and medication became leading because now we've got a few drugs to start doing some things. And so psychotherapy helped patients understand why they're acting and thinking in the ways they are. They also tried to link autism to schizophrenia. And they were treated the same way. I mean, how?
Autism
was treated the same way as schizophrenia. And then they realized, this is not doing very good with this. So some people said, maybe we shouldn't treat autism with shocks in the head. Anybody see this movie? You can tell I'm into movies.
Yes.
Great movie. True. Nash won Nobel Prize in economics. Brilliant. You know, the brilliance and then the craziness, and he's both. And he has major schizophrenia, and it follows his life, a true story. It's really awesome, I think.
The book is better.
The book is better. Okay, well, read the book. But it's true, and of course he goes through lots of shock. Insulin shock is what they did then. Electric shock. They give you insulin and make your blood sugars crash, and then you have seizures from insulin, not electric shock. And you do this repeatedly, repeatedly, repeatedly to try to bring you out of the schizophrenia. So what then is depression and how do we diagnose it in 2014? Gee. Well, on the happiness scale, I had you subjectively say, where were you on that happiness scale, right? That's what it is, a happiness scale on your homework, right? Where do you kind of live now? That was just, so you could use one scale, it's how happy am I? And just mark an X. Well, in the office, we wanted a little more. So if we want to quantitate and just get a little better. So we can use the ZUM depression self-rating scale. So if you fill this out, we can kind of, and score it, we can come up with some pretty good data here. Feel downhearted and blue, I get tired for no reason, but we quantitate it. A little of the time, some of the time, all the time. And you fill this out, and we score it and find out what your score. The key, most people with depression have scores between 50 and 69. The highest score is 80. So as Susie knows, when people come in and I talk to them, but I may give them this, she'll go in and administer it and they'll come out and I got a score. So if somebody's like 79, I go, ooh, we got a bad college student here. You know, or if they're 45, they're probably anxious and they got anxiety, but they probably don't have major depression. So, the self-administered score. The Bible, Diagnostic and Statistical Manual. This is what everything is. These are the pigeonholes today that are defined by the medical profession. And on our continuum, remember, here's happiness up here and severe depression down here. We have a chronic depressive disorder that's here. Middle. These people are called, used to call them psychothymic. That was the label we did with them. And so what's cyclothymia? Maybe some of you are cyclothymic. What's interesting about that is during the majority of days for 2 years or more, the adult patient reports depressed mood or appears depressed to others most of the day. And when depressed, the patient has two of these six symptoms or more: decreased or increased appetite, decreased or increased sleep, fatigue or low energy, reduced self-esteem, decreased concentration or problem-making decisions, feelings of hopelessness and pessimism. And during this two-year period, they've never been gone for more than 2 months at a time. So some people, we used to say temperament earlier, you just have a melancholy temperament. Well, getting a little more definition. You would go into this pigeon box, cyclothymic. And they also have to make sure you know you're not manic and you're not psychotic and you're not taking drugs and that to fill this. So that was that area on there. Major depressive disorder covers the spectrum from here on our emotional happiness down to here. And you can have mild major depression, moderate, or severe. And why does it bump on here? Suicide. So a large number of people are severely depressed. Relatively large attempt or complete suicide. So what's the criteria now for that? Okay, very specific. You have to have a depressed mood or loss of interest in pleasure and daily activities for more than 2 weeks. 2 weeks. Mood represents a change from the normal person's baseline. This is what they're like all the time. Impaired functions, social, occupational, and educational. And out of these lists, you have at least 5 of the 9 present nearly every day. Depressed mood or irritability. Decreased interest or pleasure in activities most of each day that you normally like to do. Significant weight change. Change in sleep. Change in activity. Psychomotor agitation or retardation. Fatigue or loss of energy. Guilt, worthlessness, feeling of worthlessness, or excessive and inappropriate guilt, concentration, diminished ability to think or concentrate, or indecisiveness, and suicidality, thought of death or suicide, or has a plan. Now, the change they made from last year when this came out in May, from before was, they used to kick grief out and said, if you've had a big loss and somebody's died and your spouse, and you're really bad, you got all these symptoms, we're still not calling it depression, because it's just grief. Now they're saying, maybe it really is. We're entitled to call it depression now. So that's the one only big change they made from this and the manual that went on before. And they also say, no, make sure there's no substance abuse going on. You don't have any medical illness. I had a woman who was sick last week, and she was wacko in the head, to put it in non-medical terms, and her calcium was 14. Well, that was making her brain not work well. But I think so. You gotta rule out any chemical causes for this. So, we're summarizing and say, we got 3 kind of models of mental illness now, at this time. One of them is psychodynamic, childhood experiences. You can use free association, for psychoanalysis. We have behavioral. Behavioralists say, we don't care about all this garbage. We care, just do it. You know, you're afraid of a dog, go over and pet it. We'll get a little dog, and then we'll get a bigger dog. And you're afraid to go on an airplane, I'll go with you. We'll first walk up to the plane, we'll touch the plane. In other words, we'll do the behavior stuff. Forget all what childhood trauma you had, we don't care. If we change your behavior, that's what we're gonna do. That's what the behavioralists do. And biologic says, no, there's chemical imbalance in the brain. We got all this neuroscience going on, behavioral genetics, and we got medicine it's a chemical screw-up process. We can fix that, you're gonna be okay. Afraid to go on planes, we'll give you some Xanax and you'll be okay when you go on the plane. Does work some. But everybody does this solve the problem? Maybe not, but. So you see the 3 different, so it depends what model you have of how you go and get treated. And as a patient, you choose which doctor you wanna go to. If you're a medical nihilist, You're not going to go to the doctor that's just going to give you pills. You're going to go down this way. If you're behavioralist, on this, you may say, hey, I want some of that behavioral therapy. The Broken Brain, great book. The Biology, Revolution, and Psychiatry, written by this Nancy Andreessen. She used to be an English professor at Iowa, who then became a psychiatrist. So it's a good book. But check the title, The Broken Brain. See the motto? Your brain is like a machine. It's broken. We can fix it. Okay? So, drugs take the stage. Discovery of the antipsychotics, especially Thorazine, revolutionized mental health hospitals. They came up with these drugs, which you won't go into detail, MAO inhibitors, later Celexin, Prozac, 1987. In the U.S. started the pharmaceutical revolution, which has never looked back. Currently, the medical treatment of depression is based on the neurotransmitter theory of disease. And that is this. For over 30 years, the leading theory to explain the biologic basis of depression has been monoamine hypothesis of depression. This theory proposes that depression is due to a deficiency in one or more, or one or another, of the three biogenic monoamines, namely serotonin, norepinephrine, and dopamine. So that's the current, that's that every, using the pharmacologic thing. It all has to do with those things. So, Big Moon and all of the antidepressants, Zoloft is just one of them. And likewise, for different diseases, we got different drugs. So here's just a nice little schematic of different drugs that we will use to treat the brain now. And it's all based on this theory, which I'm not going to go into significant detail about you got these chemicals that go across here, and if you use the block, this reuptake or the destruction, there's more of these guys around that will go across there. So it's all about levels of serotonin, not in your blood, but in the brain and these. So that is what the serotonin theory is about. And it's pretty complicated stuff. And we're not going to go over that. But it is not some simple thing. And that's the problem, because people try to make it simple. There's not one serotonin receptor. There are at least 15. And if you look at this, this receptor is located in the CNS. Regulates sleep, feeding, and anxiety. This one down here is in your stomach. This one does vasoconstriction in your eyes. This one I love, location, in your brain, we don't know what it does. This one, receptor, in your brain, we don't know. This one, in your brain and elsewhere, we don't know. So all the side effects and things that these things can do, it isn't some simple, oh, we just raise the serotonin in your brain and this one receptor, everything's going to be hunky-dory. But we use the verbiage, so-and-so has a chemical imbalance. Like this is some little simple thing that, oh, we're just going to give you the drug. And that's what the pharmaceutical industry sells us, that we're going to make this receptor up or down, and then that's going to make you better. And as we wind down, when someone comes to me and says, do you believe in global warming? Or is global warming right or wrong? I kind of remember my first class, Finding the Truth. And you got back and go, well, wait a minute, what are you looking for, whatever. Global warming is extremely complicated. It has no simple answer. It has all of these different variable things going on. Yes, human activities are one effect, but people forget the sun. That's kind of important. On the temperature of the planet, but you never hear people talk about that. What about all the marine biochemistry, ocean dynamics? The point I'm making here, the climate system, weather is so complicated that anybody thinks they're telling you that they know what's going on is bullcrap. They don't. It's too complicated. I'm serious. That's the way it is. And people who know will tell you that. Well, I'm telling you, it's the same thing with the brain. The brain is very complicated. This is just anatomically. You have 12 billion neurons in your brain. Some of you have more, some of you less. 12 billion. Each one of those has between 1,000 and 10,000 synaptic connections. Each one. And we're trying to figure this out as a simple model. So, do we need a better model? You know, this is a simple model, and I'm saying, my opinion, yeah. Therefore, what the next class is going to be, JR's going to invent a different model for depression that I'm going to have that's not going to throw out the chemistry part. It's going to incorporate it, but I think we need a different model for depression. And that's what we're going to develop over the next week or two. Our homework assignment this time is going to be, if you choose to do it, we have a regular piece of paper. We're not giving you out this time, just the regular size. And on one side, I would like you to write, pick a day, in the day, not the day, and write everything that bad or crappy that's going on. Anything that's a negative or a down. It could be when your alarm goes off. It could be when you look in the mirror. It could be when you fry the eggs, when you turn on the news and see more people getting killed in Syria. It can be the weather outside. I don't care. But that's your thing. You just start in the morning, have your thing, and just all the negative, anything that you personally consider, like this is kind of, it can be just little. And your cat throws up a hairball on the wall. I don't know. Put that down. I mean, you know, you got to clean it up. I mean, you know, we're not talking deep stuff here, you know. Your kid calls you and asks you for money. I don't know. But maybe that would be on the negative side. And do this for kind of day. Okay? The following day, and the order is important, get another piece of paper, or if you only get it on one side, the other side, everything that's kind of cool in the morning. You get up, hear a bird chirping outside. You see a red-headed woodpecker on your bird feeder. Your wife gives you a kiss goodbye. Somebody smiles at you. I don't know. Somebody lets you through, come to an intersection, they let you go first, even though they're supposed to. That's, well, I don't know. I'm just saying, you turn on the news, and at the very last segment, they have something that's, oh, that's kind of neat. Well, put that down. Okay? I'm going to process why that happens. Meanwhile, I got to grade all your other things and find out what we can glean from the first homework assignment, right? So thanks for your patience, and I promise no more sex.
Thank you all for coming this morning. Jim will put the homework assignment on your email, and we'll see you all back here again next week.